This series is about perhaps the most powerful idea ever to occur to a human mind. The idea is evolution by natural selection, and the genius who thought of it was Charles Darwin. I'm a biologist, and Darwin has been an inspiration to me throughout my whole career. His masterpiece on the origin of species was published 150 years ago, and it changed forever our view of the world and our place in it. What Darwin achieved was nothing less than a complete explanation of the complexity and diversity of all life. And yet it's one of the simplest ideas that anyone ever had. In this series, I'm going to set out Darwin's big idea. I'll explore how the human species has struggled with the story of its own origins, and take you into the storm that is today's backlash against Darwin. In this first program, I'm going to tell you who Charles Darwin was, explain how he discovered his theory of evolution, what it is, and why it matters. By the end, I hope to have convinced you of the truth that evolution is a fact, backed by undeniable evidence. And I want to give you a glimpse of the brutal elegance of the force which, Darwin realized, drives evolution on. Natural selection. When Charles Darwin was born 200 years ago, sailors and explorers were sending home a dizzying array of specimens like these from all parts of Britain's growing empire. Every animal was believed to have a unique place in God's creation, each made by God according to his perfect, unchanging design. At school in Shrewsbury, the young Charles Darwin was taught that God had created the earth and all this rich variety of life just 6,000 years ago. Today, thanks to Darwin, we know differently. But even now, according to polls, 4 out of every 10 British people prefer to cling to the old ideas and believe that God created our world and every living creature in it. I think it's scandalous how little our children are taught about evolution at school. A typical class gets just a few hours to study one of the most important ideas in science. This lot got me. I went to meet a science class of 15 to 16-year-olds at Park High School in London to try to open their eyes to Darwinism.
Why do we need to find out about evolution?
Why do we need to find out about evolution? Because it is the explanation for our existence, because it explains such a huge number of facts, because everything we know about life is explained by it.
I believe in my religion, so whenever I read about evolution or that, I can't understand it. I don't believe it, just like I believe my religion, so.
Right. So you know what you believe when you start, and any new book that says anything different, you don't read it, or what?
Even if we got evidence, I just like, I follow the stronger evidence, which is the Holy Book, so.
So the reason you believe it is because that's the one you were told first. Is that a good general?
I can see that a few hours in the science lab is no match for a lifetime of religious indoctrination.
I was brought up to believe it.
You're brought up to believe it. Is that a good reason to believe something, do you think?
Yeah, because I went to church since I was little, so.
Yeah, and it says it in the Bible.
Yes, but in the Hindu sacred scriptures, it says something different, doesn't it?
Yeah, but they're brought up to believe that one, then.
Yes. So you mean everybody should just believe what they're brought up to believe, even though they contradict each other?
you can be made to believe something in science, and then you can be made to believe something in religious studies. But and then it's really up to you what you believe. You can't just say that.
Well, look, I hate this phrase, made to believe. I mean, that's an awful thing, and I would hate to anybody to think I was trying to make anybody believe anything. I'm asking you to look at the evidence. Perhaps you haven't got a full impression of how strong the evidence actually is. Nobody's actually seen evolution take place over a long period, but they've seen the after effects, and the after effects are massively supported. It's like a case in a court of law where nobody can actually stand up and say, I saw the murder happen. But yet, you've got millions and millions of pieces of evidence which no reasonable person could possibly dispute. That's sort of the way it is.
There's only one thing for it. I'm going to show them evidence, something they can touch with their own hands, see with their own eyes. Later, we'll see if I can make them think again. When Charles Darwin was a teenager, he would have been as much of a creationist as some of these children. Darwin was born into a prosperous Shropshire family in 1809. His father was a doctor and keen that his son should follow in his scientific footsteps. But the adolescent Charles, more interested in shooting and fishing than academic prowess, was contemplating an easy life as a country parson. Luckily for him and for us, he had the opportunity to open his eyes to see the world. In 1831, as a young man of 22, Darwin's family connections got him a once-in-a-lifetime invitation. A round-the-world voyage on the survey ship HMS Beagle. Over 5 years, Darwin collected hundreds and hundreds of specimens to send back to the collections. But increasingly, he wasn't satisfied with just recording the animals and plants he saw. He was beginning to have doubts about the biblical story of how animals were created. While ashore, riding across the South American flatlands, Darwin amused himself by chasing after rheas, shy, ostrich-like, flightless birds. But he was puzzled. Why had God bothered to create two very similar, but slightly different types of rhea? Had an original group of rheas split in two and, once separated, started to develop in their own way? The mystery deepened when Darwin noticed an even more marked effect on islands. I was lucky enough to retread Darwin's footsteps on the Galapagos Islands last year. Here, he began to wonder why God would have created distinctive kinds of tortoise, finch, or iguana on more or less identical small islands. Were iguanas like these related rather than separately created? Were they cousins of the similar but different iguanas on nearby islands? This pattern of relationships became even more intriguing when Darwin encountered fossils.
The evidence of fossils would help Darwin develop a theory of life on Earth far more wonderful and more moving than any religious story of creation.
This team of American scientists